In this webcast, we'll be going over a practice problem from one of your old exams. It's a great way to practice some of the things we've learned in the webcasts 6.1 all the way through 6.4. Now, for this problem, we're going to finish drawing the resonance contributor resulting from the curved arrows shown there on the left. So you show all the lone pairs, all the formal charges, and then also indicate which frontier orbitals were involved in that interaction. And it'll be one of the 9 types that we've discussed so far. So in this first example, we're taking our lone pair from the nitrogen and adding it down in here to form a double bond between our carbon and our nitrogen. Now, the hint here is that this carbon is a carbene. It's a 6-electron complex. It has 2 bonds, a lone pair, and then an empty orbital. So there is a lone pair associated with that carbon on the left. So therefore, that lone pair is still going to be there in our form on the right. Our lone pair on sulfur there. For drawing in our charges, we went from a neutral species, neutral nitrogen, neutral carbon. We've now added electrons into that carbon. There are more electrons there directly surrounding it than there were before. So we have a negatively charged carbon. And we have fewer electrons directly around that nitrogen than we had before, so we have a positively charged nitrogen. Now we're adding into, this is this empty orbital onto our carbon. Now this is an sp2 hybridized carbon of our carbene, where we have in one of our sp2 lobes, we have our lone pair. Yet in this unhybridized p orbital here, we have, it's just empty. This is our a orbital. A is our empty, vacant p orbital. So what we're doing is we're taking this non-bonding lone pair around this nitrogen, and we're adding it in to where we had this, this empty p orbital on our carbene. So for adding this in to our empty orbital, definitely going to be our A type. And we started with just a non-bonding lone pair on our nitrogen. So it's going to be our N to A type. So for this interaction, we've drawn our correct Lewis structure with our lone pairs and charges in the box. And this is an N to A type interaction. Also, this is a pi type interaction because we have sideways overlap between the lone pair, the sp3 orbital containing the lone pair of nitrogen, and the empty orbital on carbon. So going on to our next example here. These are resonance forms, so our hydrogen has not moved. It's losing electrons, forming this double bond, shown here. We have our 3 lone pairs on our oxygen. Has a negative charge associated with it because we're pushing electrons towards that oxygen, away from this hydrogen, which now has a positive charge. So what we've done is we've started with this sigma bond between our carbon and our hydrogen. Got this sigma bond. Now this sigma bond is coming over here and adding into this, breaking this pi bond between our carbon and our oxygen. Therefore, adding into a pi star, since we're breaking a pi bond, we're going into a pi star. So it starts here in our sigma, ends here in our pi star. This is also a pi type interaction in the sideways overlap. Now I'm going to draw the orbitals here. It may not look all that clear. Drawing our sigma bond. I'm going to draw my pi star orbital here on my oxygen. Now, since this is a pi star, we have different signs alternating all the way around these 4 lobes of my pi star. We have this sideways overlap between our CH bonding orbital here, donating into our pi star orbital. There, it's in a pi type sideways overlap. So therefore, that hydrogen, that axial hydrogen, is indeed going to be more acidic than our equatorial hydrogen. That axial hydrogen can be removed much more easily because of this orbital overlap. Now, if I were to draw that exact same thing for that equatorial hydrogen, it would be just as we would have on our sheet one. They are going to be skew from one another. They're not going to overlap. They're not quite 90 degrees apart, but they are twisted enough apart so that there is no overlap between this bonding orbital and then this antibonding orbital. Since there's no overlap, that equatorial hydrogen is not going to be removed. So the more acidic hydrogen is the axial one instead of equatorial. And this is something that can be explained using our orbitals. So now in our bottom example, we're going in the opposite direction with a slightly different structure. This time we have our oxygen in our ring. It's coming down from a lone pair on our oxygen. We already know that that first arrow that we had comes from a lone pair on oxygen. So already, that frontier orbital where it starts with is an N, non-bonding pair, just by looking at the arrow. Comes down here, forms a double bond, okay, and then breaks this sigma bond here. So breaks that carbon-hydrogen sigma bond. So now we're putting in our lone pair and our lone pairs and our charges. There is a lone pair on the hydrogen. We have a hydride. There are two electrons associated with that hydrogen. Therefore, lone pair, negative charge. That oxygen has a lone pair and a positive charge on it. And we started with our N, and now we've broken a sigma bond. Well, since we're breaking a sigma bond, that frontier orbital, N to sigma star. Breaking a sigma bond, it's going to be pi star. Now to see what type of overlap it is, here's my oxygen. My lone pair starts in that bonding orbital there on the oxygen. Looking at the sigma star of our CH, we have that much larger lobe on the outside. So that overlap comes in there. Starts on the top, comes in there, goes into that sigma star orbital, breaks that carbon-hydrogen bond. Therefore, we have this pi type, since it's sideways overlap, pi type overlap from our lone pair on oxygen breaking our sigma star, and therefore having this end of sigma star frontier orbital interaction. Now, just like we had in our middle example here, we could not have broken off that equatorial hydrogen. In fact, that is once again rotated away from the bonding orbital on our oxygen. That sigma star orbital does not interact. It's skew. It's orthogonal to your bonding electrons. So therefore, that's the reason why the axial hydrogen leaves, but not the equatorial one.